Hey, what is up, everyone? Nice woo, thank you. Yeah, no, I had this woo. Man, it's been a while now. Probably before, it was way before Worlds was working on it. Had some influence from the woo master themselves, Greg Tung. And then it's been sleeping a little bit, but yeah, I thought I'd bring it up. Thought it'd be a fun way to start the stream. Yeah. I hope everyone's doing well. I am going to I'll go over a bit about what the Woo is trying to do. And then I think we are actually gonna have Brandon, or the King, play against us. I believe he's found an oracle to play. Give me a second. Okay. So yeah, here, I'm just gonna make the game here. I hope everybody can hear me okay. I think it's okay. But yeah, if there's any issues, please let me know. Xandarius made a slick Woo deck in 2020. Yeah, there's a lot of those like Woo Flameout builds that have been out there. I think there's a good mileage that could be done with the idea. Yeah. No, I honestly think this deck is really good. It was built to beat PD, mainly PD CTM. So I don't know how it'll do now. I don't really know how the meta's developed, to be honest. At the time I had expected no Gagarin because I thought that Apoc Max would just take it out, which it does, but I decided not to play Apoc Max. But yeah, like it was mainly designed to beat PD and CTM. I think it does a good job of that, in theory at least. There's no R&D pressure, so it's just you're just sitting on your Rezekis and playing the remote camp game. You got your 1x legwork in there, which is always nice, and also, yeah, like there's no R&D pressure. You could put a Kyushik in here or two. There's lots of two costers between Rezeki, the MK Ultra, Beth, Turning Wheel, Flameouts, and the 1DZMZ. So you can easily throw one of those in there if you want it. But yeah, let's give this a go. I believe this is the same list, and we're just going to go make a game. Let's do this. We're gonna put this in brackets for the king. And we're gonna say we are running. Yeah, and let's see what he wants to do. Aesops. Yeah. What's up, Alex? Aesop is great for selling the bin breakers and the empty flameouts over and over again, but I guess you need more than 1xD's amp full value. Yeah, you could go in that direction. I was more thinking. Yeah, I was more thinking that like you kind of just use your MK very rarely, and your paperclip kind of once you get it out, kind of just stays on the board. One thing I like about this is that. And that works with Aesops as well, is that you can put your MK Ultra on Flameout if you need money. So that's yeah. I think you can easily put an Aesops engine in here, but you'd need more support. And that was the problem, is that like if you want Creative Commission and Diesel and Dirty Laundry and the overclocks, usually overclocks end up getting cut, but I like them a lot. Put your Neuro as Mari with them, and it was epic. Neuro as Mari. So I was gonna say, I don't have a corp planned for today. So I was hoping I would run into one, or if there's any ideas that y'all want to see, then we can do that. Neuro as Mari is one. I can show you my version of Neuro as Mari. Once again, another contender for Worlds that I had thought about, but it didn't. It didn't make it all the way through testing just because I felt that it was a little bit too much of a glass cannon. There we go, fork management. Yeah, I actually really like this deck. Like, I love the influence where you play three Econ Warfare, two Government Subsidy, one Boom, and a Neurospike, and then you can play your consulting visits. So then you can consult for either Boom or Neurospike. And because you have both, you can really threaten like the Econ hard hitting and the Neurospike. And it's a big, big fork for the runner, especially early. So how I played this deck was you just get like your cheap ice down, and then you're digging as hard as possible for your re-education, and then your win condition is just getting that re-education in there and then forking the runner as soon as possible. But sometimes that fork doesn't come, and in those games, if the runner sets up, then they will probably win if you don't draw the re-education enough. Of course, that's why you got the two DRMs as well. But yeah, ultimately settled on a different deck. Check French Racing on NRDB. Here, let's see if Brandon's there. Oh, okay. Yo. Okay. All right. Let's see what they have planned here. Let's jump into this. Right. We're against a GameNet. I don't know if Brandon knows what deck I'm playing. I know that he's seen this deck before, but he might be expecting something else. We'll see. Janktivist. Can't stay long, unfortunately, but wanted to pop in and show some support for your new stream. Hey, thank you. Appreciate it a lot, man. Yeah, appreciate that a lot. I'm still working on some things. There's a couple things, like one thing's like music that I had that I just don't have. And that's because I'm like have no idea how to get music on here and what's legal and what's not. So hopefully by next week. And then also like face cam's another thing that people say they enjoy. And I think I know how to do that, but I just haven't gotten there yet. Again, hopefully next week. Is there a woo without flame out? Okay, let's see. We've mulliganed Overclock, Turning Wheel, Pollop, Diesel, and Mad Dash. This is okay. Really, turn one, like the question is just how many Rezekis can I install? And if the answer's enough, then I'll keep the hand. And if the answer is not enough, like, okay, so Pollop and Mad Dash are dead cards. Turning Wheel's a dead card as well. Like, I don't want to see that right now. Overclock and Diesel is really good, though. Especially the Overclock. Let's mulligan, because they're NBN. Like, if we were to Overclock, we can install one or two Rezekis, and then we can get hard-hitting Noozed, which could be okay, because we have Misdirection. Okay, this is better, because we got the Overclock back. We got the Anakam. We have the Dirty Laundry. We'll see if we want to play aggressive. That'll be an interesting choice. Is there a woo without flameout? So if you want to answer that seriously, I mean, yes. Like I before when there was StimHack, you could play it without flameout, or you could just play one. It was kind of like a backup. But now without StimHack, I feel like the flameout kind of replaces it. You kind of need that money boost. He's gonna Plano for 3 credits and Ice HQ Ice R&D. Ysangrin has the inside scoop on adding copyright-free music to streams. Okay, maybe I will hit up Ysangrin. I don't know. I know that they both know what the deal is with that. Okay. First turn here. We can Anakam and then Dirty Laundry. That's very attractive. And then we will get Noozed, will we? And then the question is just, are we afraid of that? We can go Anakam and then Diesel first. And then we draw 4 cards, we go to 7, and then we can Laundry, and then we can play another card. I'm okay with that. I like being a little bit greedy on the first turn, especially. So, oh, that's beautiful. Okay, so now we can Laundry Archives. And then we can play the Creative Commission. Now we're at 9, which is perfect. And then if we get noosed, we can like flame out SMC misdirection. And if we don't get noosed, then we will probably flame out and then go ahead and install 2 Rezekis at least. Might even go 3. Yeah, we could even overclock as well. If we do play the overclock, then we lose out on some flameout value, but we gain the Anakam trigger. Draw, subliminal, ice archives, though, means that we can't overclock unless we want to run into ice, which I don't really want to. So let's just install 3 Rezekis. Sounds good. So we're going to flame out, we're going to SMC, we're going to host that here. We're going to fire that, paying our flameout credits to install a Rezeki, and basically we're going to do that 2 more times. Sometimes there's a reason not to use all 3 SMCs, so you keep one for the ability to do something with it later. But if they're going to be slow, we'll just get 3 of these out and we'll just figure things out later. There we go. Yeah, maybe we'll play, if Ysengrin and the king are interested in switching sides, maybe we'll play the Ismari. Especially, Daijin, if you say you played it with the king earlier, then that'll be interesting if he's already kind of played it. Now Brandon's on the clock. Yeah, I don't know what kind of game net he's playing. I haven't heard anything about any GameNet deck, so I have no idea what this deck is doing. So I'm going into this totally blind. We see a remote happening right away. Click for a credit, last click. So I'm expecting Rashida. The great thing about this is that you can always, at any point, especially with a flameout in hand, you can at any point like just woo out a Mayfly and then go and run this. And this looks like a Rashida, right? Because we got 3 cards in hand. Like, this is a great Rashida fire. We could poke it if we want. We'll just draw. Yeah, Beth is great. Paperclip is fine. We can throw that out. So let's draw again. Falsified's good. We'll use that later. Game net is usually slow. Yeah. If this isn't Rashida, that's really good for us. They kind of need this to be Rashida right now. Yeah, okay, and there it is. So we're gonna pick up the subliminal. Because of the subliminal, making that early run's pretty good. But especially if we get this, like we have this Beth down now, so we kind of want them to be at 15 credits. And again, like as long as we just sit behind misdirection, it's good. And the great thing about having this 3 credit flameout is that if we get hard-hitting noosed, which we can't this turn, but we can always woo the misdirection onto the flameout, use the flameout credits to clear tags, and then we can woo the MK Ultra on to the flameout. And then we'd have to woo out something else to overwrite the MK Ultra. Or spec work. Or you could just not do the MK Ultra and just find a different program. Yeah, we don't have too many programs left. 2 Mayflies, N'Golo, Misdirection, EMK. And of course, you want the Mayflies to stay in your deck. Okay. So we've got a card in the server. We don't have a Mad Dash, which is unfortunate. I think we can go ahead and falsify this. So the thing is, like, if you think about GameNet, this could be a send a message, or sorry, not send a message. Tomorrow's headline. It could be tomorrow's headline, or it could be a Beal that they can score. Other than that, like I don't really see what they're threatening this to be. But I think we can falsify it anyways. Because why not? Let's guess agenda. It is an agenda. Oh, it's a send a message. I misspoke and I happen to be right. okay, we got an overclock as well. So we can just install this new flameout and then woo out a mayfly and then run it. And we should be able to break anything. We don't need to overclock. Alternatively, we could woo out a mayfly and then overclock. Which could be better. Well, we will have to deal with IP block. Potentially. Let's use the flameout credits, I think. So let's go ahead and use an overclock, use a mayfly. I could also wait and let that sit in there, but we can just get this turn, why not? And we're going to overclock the remote. So we have 8 plus 8. We have 16 credits and a mayfly to get in here. So we should be able to break anything. And then we'll probably have to clear an IP block tag because mayfly is an AI. Overclock lets me draw. No, I already used a falsified this turn. Which is why I was kind of leaning towards not using the overclocks. But like until we have breakers out, these overclocks aren't going to be used anyways, so it won't make too much of a difference. Oh, I guess you mean next turn? Oh, but like the other way would have been installing the new flameout, which would have been the same thing. Looks like we're just going to get this. Oh, we're not. Okay. Interesting. Okay, to me this is a bad res. Right? Because we're just going to spend our money from the overclock, and it's going to cost us 3 credits from the flameout. And then our mayfly is going to remove from game because of the woo, anyways. So that seems like an odd res to me. Kyle, hello? we're resing an endless Eula, which will cost us $6 no matter what. This lets us overclock into it and install Paperclip if we want, which could be a play for later. We will draw up. We're looking for events. I'd rather not draw that, but we'll pitch it, I guess. In some ways, it's worth keeping this in hand just so we can overwrite if we need to search for something. We haven't seen a sentry yet, so let's actually keep the MK in hand. Unless this is some Doom Hydra Booth remote. So the reason I'm keeping the MK in hand is if we get hard-hitting news here, I want to woo out my misdirection and use my misdirection and then y install MK over it. Actually, that doesn't make sense because I could just install this flame out. Okay, so I completely overthought. So my original thinking was that I could woo out a misdirect and then use it and then install MK to override it, but instead I could just install flameout and then use the flameout credits, and then flameout will trash the misdirect for me. Install double events. This looks like an agenda. It would make sense for them to push an agenda after I had just stolen one. Without another falsified though, I can get in there. Because I have flame out again. And this costs me, with a mayfly, it costs me 5, 6, 7, 8, plus 6 is 14, which I have. We can install a new flame out. We can use woo to install my second mayfly, because there's two in my deck. There's one left. And then we can overclock in. And that would leave a credit on the flameout, which is very useful. Do we go for this? Because this is an expensive server, which makes this push more appealing. Alternatively, we can wait for Mad Dash. That's probably the play. Laundry is not necessary right now. Creative Commission's really good. That will replace itself because of Anakam, so we'll have to discard two at the end of turn. Discard Anakam, discard MK for sure. The rest of the cards we need to hold in hand, so I think we install Turning Wheel and then play Creative. We'll draw a Diesel, which is perfect, and we'll throw the MK out. I am expecting a score here, but if it's not a score, that'd be really good for us, obviously. But if it was an agenda and we ran it, we go to 6 points, but we're a Mad Dash deck, so we can just wait. And it looks like if you see Send a Message out of NBN, that means they're probably playing Send a Message in Bellona. And they will need two more points. They're either playing like one Tomorrow's Headline, or they're playing a 15 minutes in a QPM. At this point, I'd expect Tomorrow's Headline because we haven't seen any tag ice, although we haven't seen much of the ice at all. So that doesn't really tell us too much. Okay, if I diesel here, is your woo about camping the remote? Yes. Yes, it is. As I said, I've got one legwork, I've got three falsifieds, and I got the two mad dashes. So it's about like mad dashing the remote. And there's no R&D pressure, so that's where this deck lacks a little bit. You got that one turning wheel, which I have installed. But like the longer you keep the remote locked down, the more you get value out of Rezeki, and then you can just like find single accesses, right? Okay, let's see if we diesel here. We will draw four cards, and then we have three clicks to play three cards, and we can discard the Anakam. So let's do that. Falsified's good. We don't have our Mad Dash yet. We can install the Simul Chip. We can play the Gamble, and we can install the Flame Out. That'll be the turn. And the reason is these are non-committal installs. Like I don't have to. If I install the N'Golo, I'm committing my 2MU to the N'Golo. And because we have another Mayfly, I'd like to use the Mayfly first before installing the N'Golo. And then once we get the N'Golo down, we can start like dirty laundering R&D. We can start making single access runs and getting turning wheel counters. The 1x2 Hushuk might be cool with all these two casters. Yeah, so I think I started this deck with two copies of Hushuk, and then I was testing. This was in like the month before Worlds meta. I had one or two Hushuks in here, and I was playing against all these PDs. And the thing I realized was that, well, if you can just install like your value cards and just keep the remote locked down, then you don't need the Hushuk because PD is just focusing on building their remote anyways. So they're playing this pure like tempo remote game, and if you can just counter that, then they don't really have any play. And then you can just do whatever you want from there, even though you don't have R&D pressure. And I found that the times where I drew my Hushuk, I didn't want it. Just because the decks at the time, like against CTM, against PD, it's not a necessary card if you can just keep the board under control. It would be nice for sure. Let's see what we're doing. Subliminal, Spin Doctor, draw card, click two, so they don't have what they're looking for. And they're gonna put a daily quest in there. Oh, and we found the Mad Dash. Okay, so this is where that legwork comes in great. Did they discard? They did. So they discarded two cards. So there's probably something in the bin. We probably want to push this Spin Doctor away. And then if the legwork is somewhere within the top however many cards, we could go and legwork. Alternatively, we could pressure the quest, although I think pressuring the quest is just not good. I'd like to use that last Mayfly. But maybe I don't be greedy. Because we could like install N'Golo Laundry Archives. We could also, and then we can start like playing cards to get singles, although this mad dash isn't looking great. If we run the remote, the problem with running the remote is if Daily Quest continues to come back, then that'll be bad. However, if other cards start going in there, then we can start falsified and then eventually get a win with Mad Dash. But I like this turning wheel, honestly. So we might just give up on the Mayfly. And we'll just Ingolo Dirty Laundry Archives. Force some ice to be rezzed. Yeah. Not totally sure on this play. Because we are going to need to find our 1x DZMZ to get some MU. And then we can install our paperclip. And then the MK will probably just not get installed. Although, against Turnpike, that is awkward. 2, 4, 5. It costs us $5, or we just pay four for a trace. We'll just pay four for a trace. Oh, and then they get a dollar? That's not ideal. Yeah, it might have just been better to just run the Spin Doctor and pass the turn. What do we want to do here? We could install the MK and lose a Rezeki. That's probably not good. So I think either way we say no. We can spend five, which we will. Oh, actually, I could just clear the tag. Yeah, we're just gonna clear the tag. We're about to get wrecked by QPM. That's probably what's gonna happen. But we're gonna take the tag and then we're gonna clear the tag. Otherwise, it's a 5-credit swing, so we'll take that risk. Yeah, shuffling the two cards back, drawing the other flame out, which is not necessary at this point. It's only good for our MK. The last Mayfly is probably not going to get installed. So we can. Actually, we can run again. Do I like the run? I kind of do. No Hydra. We can go clear tag run. Yeah. No Hydra res right now. 9 credits. We still have Ingolo ability to use. Another Turnpike. Dang it. That's annoying. Okay. Yeah, those might have been bad runs. We might just like sit behind our Rezeki and we'll just both drip three together and I'll just like click for 4 credits. We are looking for DZMZ though, but I like making them res ice, although like I'm definitely not gonna run HQ or archives again until I have to, or until I have something that increases the value of the run. Again, another line I could have taken was to try to contest the daily quest. But that depends on, like, if they draw the other daily quest, then that can get bad. So we'll take the less risky line. Installing ice in the remote. We're scared of border control. We're scared of Biovault. So we kind of do want to win sometime soon. But at the same time, like them being at 10 credits, they're not at a comfortable amount of credits yet. So I'd expect them to sit on this daily quest a little bit longer. And I've played a lot of daily quest decks with Brandon, and I've definitely, like at least I have come to the understanding that you want to sit on the daily quest longer than you think because you need the money. So I'd expect them to sit on this a bit longer. So I think that legwork is going to do a lot of work. We could just throw. I'm thinking about throwing an overclock at R&D. That's just bad. You know, they might have installed because of turning mill bounce. I kind of want to run R&D here just to poke, but. Do we overclock it? Just to play the card? Look for the. The problem is the overclock's going to be good later. The flameout can be thrown out. So let's just run R&D. Like, if this is an ice that's annoying, then we'll deal with it this click, and then we'll probably just click for three and throw out the flame out. We can also, like, at some point, mad dash turning wheel and go somewhere. But again, I'm pretty happy if we just both sit for 3 credits, especially with this falsified in hand. Toll booth, 3 credits for them. We can pay 3 credits for an R&D access, which sounds good to me. Unless it's a turnpike. I mean, if it's a turnpike, we'll still get in. If it's an IP block, we'll pay the trace, so we can get in here. Top card's fine. Daily quests, so that's good to know. I will let them draw this, will I? Is a non-agenda card. If I trash it, they draw a different card. I kind of want them to draw a different card right now, but is that worth 3 of my credits? If they push, like I can falsified and run, right? So they can't push next turn. I want to trash this. Is that bad? Because they draw a different card. I want them to draw a different card right now. But they'll also be slower if they don't trash this, but they want to be slower. We want them to flood up. So we're going to trash this. They're going to click for money. Both players are making 3 credits a turn clicklessly. Yeah, exactly. I like this is why this daily quest is kind of okay for me. Yeah, that was a weird decision. If I trash the other daily quest out of R&D, like it's basically do I? It's a dead card, right? It's a dead card for both of us. So it's like, is it worth paying 3 credits to trash a dead card, to kind of force them to draw a different card? And it potentially, well, I mean, it does. It increases the chance that they'll draw an agenda, which I want. They're putting a card in server one. That looks like a Biovault. I know that we played. So for those of you who don't know, I played. I mean, myself, Brandon, Bridgman. We all played a Asmari deck at Worlds that looked like this, and it was a Biovault Asmari deck. And I'd imagine what Brandon's doing right now is playing a similar list out of GameNet. The problem with that is that you'd have to play a different, like another agenda, because you have 49 cards. But I'm expecting the border control, I'm expecting Biovault. So we see the upgrade, and I'd expect that to be Biovault. Hey, good evening. How's the stream going? Good. Thanks for popping in. Yeah, playing some Anakam Wu against the king, who is with the Sengren, playing GameNet. What do we do about this? I do have a Polop. Oh, actually, Polop doesn't do anything against Biovault. We could run this now to get rid of it, if that's what I think that is. Like, I'm expecting double advance next turn. Turning wheel. We can just click for money. Because if we pass, We could also like woo out, because what is this? This costs us a bunch of money though, right? But like it might be worth it if we're clearing out a bio vault. And we also don't want to give them subliminals. So we could like run HQ, clear tag. That's not bad. So we can overclock HQ, pay 5. Yeah, let's do that. Plan of the King seems to put 3 to 5 ice on remote while waiting to be super rich. This would be actually a good plan. Oh yeah, it's good. We tested this deck and found it so miserable and nobody wanted to play it. Like one step above Depression Palana. Okay, I mean we tested all of it. We've tested Palana. We were extremely close to bringing Palana. Extremely close. Do I want to give him money? No. So I'll pay. Oh, actually, I have the 5 credits here anyways. Yeah. It was depressing to play against. Yep. Yeah, we had a grinder Palana. We were very close to playing it. IP block, good to know. Drawing a gamble. We'll play that next turn just to get our Anakam trigger, so we'll just take 3 credits. Yeah, we were super close to playing Grinder Palana. But then we found the Asmari deck, and we were very happy with that. So we ended up switching to what we saw to be like a more consistent deck. But yeah, no, we had a Grinder Palana on shipment from Tenon, staying House of Knives, and like you'd kind of sit there and install n nothing except ice and upgrades on your centrals, and then you try to shipment from Tenon out and grind the runner to death. It was really good. It was really good. Yeah, it was really good. And especially like if you're expecting max, like you basically have to draw your rebirth. If you're big max, but if you're big max and you don't draw your rebirth, then you still lose. And it just really felt like from the runner side, like there was just nothing you could do. GameNet's the reason for Gold Farmer ban. Gold Farmer is just a really good card. Ice HQ, credit. And we drew because of Beth. Okay, this is super interesting. So why did we take 2 credits to go to 13 instead of double advance and go to 9 if this is BioVault? Right? Like, are you like this R&D ice? You can live without rezzing that. The remote ice, you can also live without rezzing. So, like, the explanation, I guess, is that this is Hydra. But we just saw IP block. And if you put an IP block here, that's pretty good, right? So why are we not double advancing this unless it's not BioVault? I might run this just to prevent, like I want to deny subliminal. Might be AV. What is AV? I think we're going to start by playing. Oh, Void. Oh, that's true. That's true. Brandon is a void kind of guy. Even though we played a bunch of BioVault and found that to be really sick. Legwork. Legwork is good, although we can probably milk this for another turn. Unless we want to just legwork now. We could legwork now. Oh, no. Okay, we're gonna just run here. We saw an IP block. I'm expecting this to be IP block, so let's make them res it. It's Turnpike. That's annoying. Fine. Yeah, a lot of Rezekis. There were 3 of them on turn 2. On turn 2, we had a flame out down and we went Woo Rizeki, woo Rizeki, woo Rizeki. It was great. We're gonna take the tag here, and then we're gonna check out. And then we'll just clear tag and play the commission. Part of me actually wants him to double advance void here, because we can legwork, and then if we get voided, then we can mad dash back in. And that's actually better for us. And if he doesn't vault, then there's probably nothing in HQ. Oh, okay. So it is void. We're single advancing. So it's a headline. We have five clicks, which is excellent. What other breakers do you have? We have an MK and a paperclip in the bin. And we have one DZMZ in the deck, which is where the one extra MU is. So we only have six MU. If we have the DZMZ down. So if we want to have all our breakers out, then we'd have to lose the Rezeki. But right now, this is all we got. What is this? This is a headline, right? So we're like running HQ with a mad dash here and using turning wheel counters. Or we could legwork and then mad dash R&D with turning wheel counters. Although I think there's some in. I think there's one in hand. What are we single advancing? I guess we can just find out. Yeah, let's find out. It is a sandbox. Okay. It's a sandbox. It's a sandbox. What do we do about that? Diesel? We do have a Paul op, right? So if we diesel into Paul op, run HQ, install Paul op, run the remote is a possibility. Although we'd probably have to like rip up our board in order to make all those runs. But it's totally doable. We can also ignore it and give them the score. Is deep dive legal? It's not, right? It's just been announced and people have been playing it, pretending it's legal. We could run it and get voided. We could legwork. Okay, so the fact that this is not a it's not. So I think we want to legwork here. And then we can just like MK through. We can just MK through this and Digirezeki. That seems good to me. Not legal, but why not? Yeah. Yeah, so because this is not a headline, I can sit on my wheel a bit longer. So we'll install this and Digirezeki. No. Then we'll just pay with MK. I think this is better with the flame out, right? We did the other two are in the bin, but the only thing that we'd use flame out for is misdirection, or the last Mayfly if we ever install that, or we could simulchip Mayfly. So there are uses for it, but we'll just do this. P block, F2P, pop-up window. Okay. So we were kind of hoping for trashables as well, but none of those. So we probably just leave this. I P block, F2P, and pop-up window are fine. We could like bounce here and then mad dash R&D for four if we want. That's not even that bad. Do we do that, chat? Are we not gonna fish for Polyp? We could do that too. We could diesel and then if we draw Polyp, we install Polyp and then run. I mean, we did commit the MK already, so we you could say like might as well. Yeah. I mean, let's do this. Okay, we didn't find it. We didn't find it. I really want to mad dash R&D. Right? We're gonna do it. I think this is a very entertaining play. Gonna say YOLO. Oh, wait. Does this make sense? Oh, wait. We should actually bounce. We should actually bounce R&D so we keep money on the flame out because we're going to use it eventually. So we should actually run we're going to bounce here and then we're going to mad dash in and we're going to C4. We got that polyp still. There's also one more falsified in our deck. So we have one more kind of, you know, R&D ch or remote check that's pretty strong. F2P. This costs us $4 and they get two. Or it costs us $6 and three of them's off the flame out. Two, four, six. Yeah, let's just break it with MK. Right. One, two, three. I'm expecting this sandbox to be a one of. Because, like, we see send a message and Bellona, and it's very, very rare that you'll see send a message and. Like, it's very rare you'll see both, you know? Unless this is a one of. Like, it could be a send a message one of, three Bellona, and then a bunch of two pointers. All right, here we go. Hedge fund. Rashida. Rashida can go. Skunk Works. Skunk Works is fine. We have Polyp for the void. This is a lot of influence. Unless that is Skunk Works. Like, we might just be against Skunk Works. Let's trash this. Hedge fund, F2P. And we lost overclock. Fine. I'm gonna give him a sandbox score. Trashing two cards out of R&D is kind of scary because they are gonna see fresh cards. Relatively soon. So it might have been good to give them the skunk. Almost considering bouncing for turning wheels. We don't need to, though. Do we need to? Nah, right? We can just money back up. The great thing with Tollbooth is that if you have less than three credits, you can just bounce off this. So if we go like install DZMZ, we can run this four times, and then we can end the turn on two credits. And we'll get four turning wheel counters. And like they draw again, right? So they're gonna have to ice this. Whereas otherwise they wouldn't ice this, because if we money up, they're not gonna ice this. That's tempting. Very tempting. It's got the falsified. We're gonna make that play. Yeah, because there's no news. Like we're clearly just a and also it makes the run for the subliminals. Oh, it gives them money? That's fine. Oh, actually, no, it only gives them money the first time. This is gonna fire. And then we're gonna bounce. Oh, I don't have to click that again. MB has a pull request for deep dive up. I'm not quite sure what that means. Oh, like for JNet? Like deep dive seems like such a hard card to do manually because I assume it's not implemented at all, right? So you're just like putting in some random card as a placeholder, and then you gotta like run HQ, run R&D, run archives, and then you gotta like get the other. You have to get the corp to look at the top eight, tell you what they are. That seems like a lot of work. GameNet is whenever, but I only lost credits the first time. Because I was at two credits afterwards. So yeah. So we would go hedge fund, double ice. So this is good, because now, like, they didn't draw. I think we can sit on this remote now. And again, like, we have another falsified, right? And then if we sit long enough, we can turning wheel again. I don't really want to give them the subliminals, but they've probably put like F2P on the outside, which is the most annoying one. And if they did, then, which they probably did, and like money doesn't matter here, so we'll just let them have their subliminals. Take a dollar, gamble, and we will just draw our polyp. We can go ahead and draw our falsified as well. I guess we could laundry archives if we want to prevent the subliminal. Though we can just do it next turn. So, because the Mr. X is useless, I think. Yeah, so we'll just draw again. Okay, so we got that. Mistrek can go. The Mayfly will probably never get installed. You never know. I'll just throw the Mistrek out. Doesn't matter. What's the last card? Spec work. Spec work is the last card. Wouldn't I rather laundry HQ for wheel and polyp? Yes, very true. I would. That's a good call. That is something I'll need to do, hey? And like, we'll have to decide this turn. Because like, we can either hold the polyp and then be like, surprise, we have polyp. When they throw something in there and they think it's safe, or we can install the polyp early, which is a safer thing to do, and then they will be a little bit more scared about it. And then it might slow them down a turn. So it'll depend on whether or not we think we need that extra turn. Because right now it's really just about our money. Draw a card, install, take a credit. So we're. This is threatening tomorrow's headline. Do we need to respect that now? We do, don't we? How many fresh cards did we draw? Mandatory was one fresh, draw was two fresh. So we saw two fresh cards, and we would lose if this is headline. We've seen Skunk Works and nothing else. It would be safe if we falsified it to see what it is. I think we do, right? That's what this card is here for. Okay, that's good. So that's a skunk. We don't need the spec work for now. Because we're gonna like MK, right? We're gonna MK through this to install the polop. Like honestly, at this point, like it might just be money up and then turning wheel R&D again. Because we don't actually have that much money. So this polop might end up not being used. Although it could be. It depends on how long it takes them to jam. And it could be a while. It could be next turn. We can install the Mayfly and then spec work it. Let's just take four. Yeah, like I imagine what's gonna happen here is we're gonna do a last ditch turning wheel run. See how many counters we can build on that, and then just mad dash R&D and hope to find a Bellona. We're drawing. I mean, that's good, because if they find any agenda, they would just throw it in there, because I'd imagine they feel that the remote is safe. Like I said this before, that they could just be on skunks and no void, but knowing Brandon, I would expect him to have both. So I fully expect that other card to be a void. So we are gonna need to polop it and deal with skunk and deal with the three ice that's there, which we can't do that right now. Because it would cost us. Let's assume we have the polop down. So it would cost us one to use the polop. Two, three, four, five, six. Plus six is 12. So we would need 13 credits plus whatever this is. And then two clicks for the skunk and then probably five to steal Bellona. So we would need 18 plus whatever this is. We're almost there, I guess. They're thinking. Which is a good sign. Maybe they're thinking about where they want to install an ice. Probably doing the math on if they can res all their ice. That's not right. Oh, they're just going to take a credit. Okay. That's funny. So, what happened there was they played Subliminal and they spent a click to play Subliminal because it wasn't the first time they played a copy of Subliminal. And then they discarded one. It is just better to click for a credit and then discard the subliminal because then the subliminal would be face down instead of face up. But small difference here. Okay, so this is good for us because we have a turn now. We have a turn where we're not threatened by here. We can just get money, and we're probably just going to click for five. Unless, honestly. The reason they were thinking might have been because they have a Bellona in hand. And they were maybe considering whether they put it in the remote or they wait a turn before install double advancing. I can see that, but it is safer in the remote than HQ. I think. Yeah, especially if it's Bellona. Install Mayfly spec work is a pretty funny play. Although we probably go like install Mayfly and then run here. Just because. Actually, what barriers do we need to break? We would need to prevent ourselves from taking a tag if the inner ice is IP block. Oh no, because we'll have to break the IP block anyways. So yeah, we probably have to install this Mayfly. Okay, we'll just take four, five. Like, I think we're gonna pick a turn. We're gonna pick a turn where we go get turning wheel counter, and then probably spec work something, and then mad dash R&D. And then we have the simul chip where we can pull out a Mayfly. Or we can pull out paperclip, because I think. Yeah, there's a few things we need to break. Install a card in the remote and advance. Looks like they don't want to sync double advance. They're going to put another ice on R&D. Yeah, okay. So this is a sandbox. So this is a sandbox, and they're going to ice R&D. And this is the last turn. I've covered up your N'Golo, so you can't use it. But did you consider that my window is zoomed out further than yours? The counters. Okay. Five clicks. Are we just screwed by border control? What is the influence count? So if we have eight on Void, four each, and they have two, and we have six on Skunk, because we've seen at least two Skunks, so that's 14. And then we have one influence somewhere else. So if Brandon is on one, if Brandon's on two voids, then there's no border control. If Brandon's on one void, then he would have five influence, and he would be able to put in one border control and two extra influence. And I'm gonna say that since you can't put in two border controls in exchange for one void, then he would rather put the void in. So I'm expecting no border control. I hope y'all are able to follow that. So can I make three runs? Spec work and then mad dash. Yes, I can. Yes, I can. Okay, so we're gonna make three runs, spec work, and then mad dash. Let's laundry first. We'll see where we get from there. We'll have to check our credit total. Because, like, there are a lot of things we can ignore, right? Like, Turnpike, we can ignore. F2P, we can ignore because it's on the inside. So you can bounce whatever. So we have to break the toll booth. And then we've seen another F2P, which we would have to break. We might not, because we'll have Simulchip and N'Golo, so we might be able to ignore it. And we'll also have to break IP block, which we can paperclip. And then pop-up window costs us one. And then I don't know what other ice we've seen. I don't think we've seen anything else. Okay, let's get oh, beautiful. What is that? Wait, how did that happen? What? They mandatory drew, installed a card, single advanced, and iced R&D. Why do they have another agenda in hand? What is happening? Can somebody tell me? I'm so confused. So we can like polop run the remote now, right? Right? Whoa. Might as well just get the agenda in the server now. Yeah, Janktivist, that's exactly what I'm thinking. We might lose our wheel though, because we did take two tags. Because we go install, polop, run the remote. If it's not an agenda, that is. Is there a reason this is not an agenda? No, right? There's no reason this is not an agenda. Right? Okay, let's run the remote, I guess. Yeah, there's no reason this is not an agenda. Okay, this costs us 6, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. It costs us 18. And then we have $5 for bologna. Although this, like, there's also no reason this is bologna because they iced R&D instead of double advancing. So we all, yeah, like the problem is we're not gonna have enough to steal Bologna if we have to polop, but let's break this. We're giving them a bunch of game net money. Probably shouldn't give you six. It's fine. We'll just give them money. It saves us money to give them money. So that's exactly what GameNet wants you to think, right? So that's fine. We'll give them $6. I just steal this, right? This is like, if this is NGO, I guess you just pulled off the ultimate bluff where you had a sandbox in hand and you instead installed the NGO. Like maybe they were expecting the polop, so they were expecting us to make the remote run, and they thought the remote wasn't safe. That's a possibility. Okay. Is an agenda? It is. Whew. How did you have two agendas at start of last turn? GameNet is finally working on JNet. Yeah, I think it's automated too. Yeah, that was odd, having two agendas at the start of last turn. The turning wheel dig didn't work the first time, so it's a good thing I didn't have to do it the second time. Interesting game though. The polyp ended up saving me. Taking advantage of turning wheel bounces is good pressure. We drew one sandbox a turn for two turns, but the first one we drew that the previous turn on click two. Ah, okay. So they had one, they drew on click two on this turn here, the turn where they played the second subliminal. So they didn't want to just throw that in the remote, which I think they should have, but obviously they don't know what I have going on. But yeah, they drew the sandbox on click two. They didn't want to put it in the remote, so they played the subliminal, or in other words, they clicked for a credit, and then they were going to install it next turn. But instead, they still did that, but they mandatory drew another sandbox. And I was just lucky enough to pull the one in five and then run the remote. So Brandon is cursing at my RNG skill for pulling the one in five out of hand. JNet coughs again. Okay, but was there, but check RNG, is there Bologna in top? What would have been? We would have accessed five. Okay, we check R&D. Is there Bologna in top five? You wouldn't have found it. Ah. Bologna number nine. Dang. All right. Let's see if they want to play against it. Daojin, here's the deck. French racing. Yeah, let me see if I can pull it up on here. Deck lists. We are looking at, oh, actually, I should look at factions. So we'll go to NBN. We'll go to Azmari. We're looking for French racing. There it is. You got a Jeeves? Oh yeah, okay. So this is the other way of building that Azmari, is that you play seamless, and you kind of really go all in on this re-education, with no punishment. So and you're also at 40 cards, which I think is very, very justified, because your whole deck is just getting it in the run or getting an ice. But like the problem is, oh, you only care about the end runs, right? You only care about ping and Enigma, because you're not playing an economic game. You're just playing a rush game. So you're rushing this re-education to try to get your seamless Neurospike win, which is fine. Like the reason that I went the other way is because I think once people know what's going on, then they can. They it's so much easier to beat this compared to a version where you play where you have the Econ Warfare Hardening News Fork. Let's see what they said. I might play one so we don't end up trapped in a prison again. Actually, I want to corp. So for the king, but mind if I corp? And then we'll write streaming live. Standard. Okay. Right. Yeah, we're gonna ask if we want to corp, if we can corp, because I do want to show off the Azmari. Because it is fun. Why is this on IP block over wrap round? Yeah. This is 7 to 9 turn deck. Okay, later, Janktivist. Thanks for coming by. Why is this on IP block over wraparound? Have we already discussed the deck being 40 cards? It is hard to set up in 7 turns. Fastest was 3 or 4 turns. Yeah, so like this deck, this version of the deck is able to set it up much more reliably, I would imagine, because you're playing Special Report and you're playing Sprint, whereas I'm only playing DRM. But the thing is, like, there's no punishment. So like in the early game, the runner, like if I knew what was going on, like you can just run, just try to get those accesses, because there's no like run punishment. And then you're kind of like the issue with this is that like with PD running around, and like again, like I'm kind of talking from the world's meta, which might be right now, might be not. But like everybody was playing like Inside Job or like some way of getting into a remote, even if it wasn't advanced. But certainly like this can catch a lot of people off guard. Because you can do like, turn one, you just re-education ping if you draw the right cards, and then you can seamless and just Neurospike it. Which is great. Yeah. Festus was 3 or 4 turns. Yeah, it's a scary deck. It's very scary. And again, like I was really, really considering this style of list. That's what I assumed you meant by switch. Oh yeah, okay, here, we're gonna play my version. Do I not have it here? Do I not have this deck on my account? Whoa, I must have deleted it. That's odd. Vault Azmari. I guess I don't. Oh, it's called cake. Okay, we're just gonna go ahead. We're just gonna delete this and then re. Is that what it's called? Oh, I changed the name. I see. Okay. Fork management. And it is an Asmari deck. Right. Brandon has played this before. There's very few decks I have that Brandon doesn't know of, but there's a lot of versions of Asmari that we've played. So I still prefer my Rig Shooter version of this deck. It's beautiful. It definitely is. Yeah, the Rig Shooter version was really strong. Uh-oh. That's not good. How much ice do I have? I have 12 ice. That's not a good hand. We've got the news though, so it's fine. Brandon's playing 45 card max. That's fun. Is this what this is, Kyle? This is prepaid VoicePad Max, except it was trimmed down to 45. We decided that there were too many cards that were just not events, so we're going to like play 45 cards, Mystic Mamie, prepaid VoicePad, and we're gonna have three Laborites, and then we're gonna go to zero cards in deck, and then we're gonna Laborites like sure gambles. So you can start gambling for nine. That's the dream. How much ice do you have here? Yeah, you have 13 ice. One more than I was able to fit in. That's because of the operations though. Like, I love this because you can play the Econ Boom package with Consulting, and you can play one Neurospike. And like the fact that you have one of each operation with the Consulting just gives you so many options. Enjoying your commentary and talk through your planning. Hey, thank you. Welcome to the stream. This will be That's the idea of what I'm doing here, is that I talk more through my plays, and I generally I like I know a lot of other streams kind of focus a bit more about like overall like beginner new player friendly, which is great. But like the one thing that I won't do is kind of talk about what cards do. And of course, if you don't know what a card does, just have like NetRunnerDB open and then you can look it up from there. Okay. They kept. Again, don't know what kind of max this is. We found an ice, which is great. Although there's nothing we need to protect right now, so I think I just wanna get the NGO out. So then we can play the government subsidy next turn. So we're just gonna double advance that. And then against Anarch, I like naming resource. Because Brandon likes to play, well, I mean, Brandon likes to play, but also like most Anarchs play like their daily casts and companions and liberateds. So I'm gonna name resource, which I would say is unorthodox, because you usually like just name event, and that's like a very safe call. I fully expect them to like the other thing about NGO is that they might respect hard hitting and they won't run. Looks like they're gonna poke this, which is fine. Waste them a click. It is important to note that we can't Econ Warfare because it was not a successful run. However, we can hard hitting. So they will have to respect that we can hard hitting, but we cannot Econ Warfare because Econ Warfare requires a successful run. 45 card may also be high my max. Yeah, so time to make a Twitch card bot. Consulting for Neurospike can be so click intensive. That's true. But yeah, like as Joe said here, it could be high mind max, and seeing the tranquilizer off the top on the max mill tells us it's probably high mind max. So from now on, we're probably calling program because high mind max runs like 20 programs. They're probably gonna, like, Progenitor's gonna come down. Progenitor, Fermenter, Hivemind. Lot of programs they want to install. We have CTZ, who pretty much only makes sense if you've been playing for 5+ years. I've never seen CTZ stream. Do they stream at a set time, or do they like stream events that they play in? I didn't know that they streamed at all. But now I want to know what you're talking about. Can recommend. It only makes sense if you've been playing for 5+ years. I'm very curious as to what that might look like. Okay, we're playing Moshing, which is a great card. Botchless Progenitor Daily Cast. So now we know for sure, as if we didn't already, that they're on Hive Mind Max. And then they're going to gamble, which is good for them. They have their money up. We can't lose. And then they're going to discard Hive Edwards. So, yeah, like they're just playing their money to respect the news. So again, I'd expect myself to be able to call program and for that to land decently well. So the important thing about this deck is that you really want to rush to find your re-education. And I tested this deck a bit before. You actually scoring Bellona is actually a waste of time. And like I have Bellona in my hand right now, and I'm never gonna score this, and I'm never gonna install it because you just want to find re-education and score, or like threaten to score re-education as fast as possible. And this Bellona's purely a waste of time. So that's why, like, I think if we were like a normal quote unquote Asmari deck, we would probably go like Ice HQ, Ice R&D, Government Subsidy. But because I'm not concerned about this Bellona, we're gonna draw. Okay, so then we're gonna put the IP buck on R&D because the ping is good for the remote. And I'm gonna play this. We'll play the government subsidy while we can. And like, yeah, we're just digging for re-education and throwing that down as fast as possible. Because A, the faster you can do that, the faster you can score it and neurospike them, or they run it when they're not ready, and then you can econ hard hitting. And the later the game goes, the harder that'll be to do. And like you'll get to a point where it will be impossible to do. So here we go. Samwell Chip Fermenter discards MK. Makes sense. We found econ. Depending on how aggressively we want to play this, we could consult for DR for digital rights management right now. They stream the Games Enter event. Oh, it's Sansan. Honestly, I didn't know that. I didn't know what Sansan's stream was. So good to know. Yeah, next time I see that, maybe I'll jump in. We could consult here. Like you could just consulting visit for DRM, and then we can put the re-education, put the ping out. The problem is they can paperclip it, and then, like, they can wait a turn, and then I would triple advance, and then they would paperclip their way in, and then I probably don't have enough to kill them. So I think we have to draw and set up, unfortunately. The one thing you can do is use the Bellona as bait, so we might end up doing that. So let's draw. Okay, that's fine. So we'll just install Bellona, install ping. It depends on what they want to do, right? Because it's like, if I did go for that play and we put the re-education and the ping out and they set up for a turn in and then run it the next turn, like I think they can do that because they have their fermenter down. But the problem is like they can do it anyways. So we really need them to bite on this Bellona. If they don't, then we might run into problems. Also, we're gonna be triple advancing this because we want to threaten Neurospike. Like, if we double advance, they can just ignore it. The thing you have to remember about Hive Mind Max is that, like, even though they have 9 credits now and like a ticking fermenter, they still have things that they need to install. It's like Namkiri cost them 5. Their hive mind costs them three. They have to get a progenitor down. If they're playing daily cast, which I don't, but if they are, that costs money to go down as well. There's reasons for them to decrease in credits, even though they might not run, which they won't until we threaten something. Cookbook, knob. Oh, wow. Oh, this is really good. Okay. Oh, we drew the DRM. Am I sticking to my principles of Bologna doesn't matter and it's only re-education? We can DRM re-education double advance. Or we could triple advance the Bologna and make them scared of re-education. What do we think? Do we think they're gonna bite if we triple advance? It's such a risk. Because if we triple advance and they ignore it, then that's really bad for us, and that we might even just lose the game there. But they obviously would be taking the risk that it is re-education. If we don't, and we just DRM for re-education, and then double advance, they could be scared of seamless, which I don't play. Oh, you want me to zoom in? I can zoom in. How do I zoom in? How's that? We can play like that. Yeah. We can play like that. Yeah. Yeah, if there's any card that you want me to hover over, I'm happy to do that as well. I think we might DRM. Because, for them to get Nobkiri value, they have to run. And if they run, we can econ hard hitting. So we're gonna be real on our threat, if you know what I mean. Let's install this in server 2. We're gonna double advance it. We're gonna name program. This is a really aggressive play. You should turn on the setting that keeps the last hovered card on display. I didn't know that existed. I will look into that after the game. I imagine, like most JNet settings, I'll have to reload JNet after enabling it. So, yeah, I'll do that after the game. Yeah, the last play here, if I triple advance the Bologna, it's only good if they respect the re-education. But if they don't, then we kind of have to go for this. So we'll take the aggressive route. You can access it from settings above the chat log. Like this chat log? Oh. Stack cards. I remember that. I don't have that on. Keep Zoom cards on screen. Yes. Card text. Not sure what that means. Save. Am I good? Oh, there we go. Okay. Wow, they're running it now. Okay, what happened? They ran HQ. They accessed Neurospike, which is great because they see this, but not the rest of our garbage. They hit the fermenter and they run the remote. So now we res ping. So they have to take a tag here. They're going to install paperclip for four. They're going to break for one. And then they're going to clear the tag. And they're going to be on. Oh my goodness. They're going to be on four credits if they clear the tag. The double advance threatens the kill if I have seamless. Which I don't. So, no, it doesn't threaten the kill. But they could be scared of seamless. The way that I just played this deck looks exactly like the way that Daojin's list kind of looks like. Except I don't have this list doesn't have DRM. But most re-education decks play seamless instead of the kill package. I find the kill package a bit more consistent, but the seamless is on people's minds, right? Okay, so we're going to install the botulist, so we're going to respect hard hitting. If they keep the tag, they'd really be respecting hard hitting. Although they'll lose the cookbook, so that'll be really inconvenient for them. So yeah, I'd imagine they will clear the tag. I never respect the possibility of seamless in the re-education decks. I would probably do the same. Ooh, we drew the other one. That's good. This botulus is good enough on this ping until we find another ice though. So what is this? This is econ hard hitting. Are we gonna like aggressively install this re-education? Mad Dash Archives for the sick win. Do we aggressively install this re-education? This would be great if we had Rashida. Or Spin Doctor. We might do it. We'll go like install econ hard hitting. Yeah. Aggressively install the Bellona. So that's the thing. Like, Bellona doesn't matter. It's just, it doesn't matter unless it's, unless you're gonna lose the game. Like, the only benefit of scoring Bellona is to get 3 points out of the deck, which is a great benefit. But it's generally a waste of time. So, and like, they're not gonna run this, right? Like, if they run this, they're dead to boom. So they're not gonna run this. And they're going to take a turn doing whatever, probably clearing tags. If they don't clear tags, they die to boom. But if they do clear tags, then we can hopefully like top deck or draw into ice, and then we can put another ice on here and then go again. This deck is like this Asmari is great when the runner doesn't have the answers, but against a runner that has reasonable answers, it's tough. It's really tough. They lost Chisel, lost Progenitor. Like, we're looking for Enigma here. Like, we find an Enigma or even another ping or IP block. Like, anything's fine, really. Then we can put another ice in advance. Do we trash the cookbook, maybe? Oh, that hurts. Oh, actually, we can just naked install this. Yeah. We can hedge fund now, or we can trash the cookbook. If we hedge fund, we will be able to play faster in a future turn. If we trash the cookbook, we will slow them down. We're gonna trash the cookbook. We're going to name program. How many progenitors are left? There's one progenitor left. What do they have that they can play at cheap? Like, they're probably just taking 4 credits, right? So I'm trying to figure out what they have that they can get out of their hand if they don't want to discard a card. Progenitor would be the ideal scenario for them. Fermenter would be great as well, so we're going to call program. Also, like, this naked Rashida is safe because we are threatening hard hitting. If they run this, we'll consult hard, like we'll hedge fund consult hard hitting. And then we'll probably win from there. So that's why they can't run this. Click for three, install fermenter is expected. So we will fire this Rashida. Then we can hedge fund, put an ice on here, probably single advance this, and then we'll get it to one advancement. Actually, there's no reason to advance this. Oh, we have planogram. That's kind of sick. Okay, so this ping can get trashed no matter what we do. So we can probably like overwrite the ping and go install ping, install turnpike. Install ping, install turnpike, and then we could single advance or we could play the hedge fund. But I think we would rather single advance. We could also put an ice on HQ. I'm not excited about that. Because, like, the one thing you should consider is that As long as we have HQ open, they're never going to run archives. So this Bellona is safe in archives. But if we ice HQ, then they might run archives for a Nob Kiri token. And we don't want that. Whereas HQ is a 1 in 5. Although if they trash our boom, that's pretty bad as well. But I think that's a risk we'll take. So let's install here. Let's install here. I guess we play the hedge fund. Okay, this is important. How much money do we need? This costs us 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So we're credit perfect and we're gonna get money from Asmari. So we might actually not need this hedge fund. If the alternative is that they run and then we consulting visit for hard hitting. And if we do that, that costs us 5 credits, which is equivalent to playing Neurospike in the double advance on their education. And then we'll probably get money off Asmari. So we're going to single advance this. Yeah. Let's pitch the hedge fund and we'll keep the plano. Yeah. Program. The math for advancement actually works out such that we should hedge fund and then next turn we'll triple advance because you want it at 3. Because at 3, you can advance, you'll be at 5, you score and last click Neurospike. The reason that we're single advancing is so that next turn we're basically spending a click now in exchange for a free click next turn. So next turn we're going to double advance and then we have a click. And if we draw like a spin doctor, we can install the spin doctor. They clear the tag, take 2 credits, install Paladin, which is great for us. We draw another Bellona. That's not ideal. I mean, it's fine because they have $1. So we'll go ahead and double advance and play this for money. Naming program again. And they know we have Neurospike in hand, right? They've accessed it. So they have to go for this. Unless they mad dash and win somewhere. But with them on 1 credit, they're gonna have to like pop Fermenter and then mad dash archives or mad dash HQ, which is possible. What would they think the Bellona in archives is other than a Bellona? It was overwritten by the re-education install. Rashida would have fired, daily quest would have been pre-res, and there are other possible includes that I'm just forgetting. That's true. That's like good, very good analysis. Spin Doctor is like, yeah, like it's a yeah, it could be, I guess. Unlikely, because you probably would have resed it to draw. It was sort of situation that needed me to draw the recursions. Like it could have been. Yeah, nothing comes to mind right now. Okay, so they're gonna try to imp it. Install imp run HQ. Fair enough. So they have 3 runs on HQ. They found a Bellona, which they're gonna leave there because they need to imp the Neurospike. If it wasn't Sokka with knowledge of this deck, could be a failed snare as well. That's true. There are a lot of people that like their snares. Oh, we're gonna rebirth into Kim because they wanted to trash the Bellona. So we have a 1 in 4 to win the game right now. Otherwise, do we win anyways? No, because they have imp. Oh man, GG. Choose a card to move to the bottom of R&D. 1, 2, 3. Four. Done. Done. Yeah, they were on 0 credits, so we would have consult hard hitting if they had hit it. And then it would have been an interesting game from there. Because we would have had to ice HQ, hopefully, and then consult hard hitting. To try to like protect from the imp. And then there's like 2 Bellonas in the bin, so. Yeah. Got to dip. Great stream, Sokka. Hey, thanks. Thanks for stopping by. What was the remote? Turnpike into ping. And then consult boom in hand. I should write that the other way. If I write consult boom in hand, that makes it look like that could be misinterpreted it as I have consult and consult can get boom, but I had both. So I'm gonna write it the other way. Yeah, this is against somebody, like a pair of players who are careful. Like there was a couple times I know where I was just playing this deck, and if you queue into it just in the casual lobby, you will like generally I'd say like the average person is not as careful, so like you'll probably just get a lot of wins just because you have three Econ Warfares and three hard hitting and a boom in your deck. Yeah, and the third is in the bin since turn three. Re-education kill in general is kind of a pub snobber. Yep. I'm not totally familiar with what pub snobber means. But I can imagine the general idea of what that would mean. It's fun. It's fun when it works. When it works, it can be crazy because you go like re-education, put a thing there, put an ice there, and then you get a bunch of money from Ismari, and then sometimes you don't even need to play your hedge fund. Like I did this game, like I just didn't play the hedge fund. Yeah. Oh yeah. Okay. I think I have time for one more game. What do y'all want to see? I played the Ismari. I played the Wu. I could play the Wu again. I could play something else. I could play Steve. I play Reg Steve. Or some other deck that y'all have. I could play the Maw Max that I was playing last week with Brandon. This is a fun deck. And like reg decks are just fun to me, because like especially when you're playing a reg deck, you can there's a lot more like player discretion. I can do what I want. I can explain why I'm doing something better, I think, if you're playing a reg deck, because if you're playing something with a set game plan, there's a bit less choice, I feel. Mistake was running turn one because I forgot Nearest Bite costs credits. One day I'll remember how cards work. What deck do you think you'll miss most once rotation hits? Honestly, I haven't thought about rotation at all. So I don't know what decks are going to be gone when rotation hits. What is rotating? Let's see. So Sansan's is Sansan already gone? Like I think Mumbad's leaving, right? And there's like a bunch of powerful cards in Mumbad. If you have a way to play Khan, that would be something. Mumbad and Order and Chaos rotate. Order and Chaos. There's a bunch of good stuff in Order and Chaos. Let's look at this. Lakshmi, Jeeves. Ooh, I can show y'all my Acme Jeeves deck. Let's do that. That's a fun deck. Any deck, and Brandon agrees. Any deck where you have Jeeves and Sandbox, and you can purge and then do something is a fun deck. If I have a way to play Khan, I don't have a Khan deck right now. Maybe next week I can, like, we can try something out. Like, we can try to build a con deck. That's something that I'd be up for doing. Yeah, I'll think about it during the week, and then if there's some way to kind of put an engine together, which I'm sure there is, we can do something like that. Okay. Yeah, let's play, because Jeeves is rotating. So let's do that. I'm gonna show y'all my Acme deck that plays Jeeves. It is not this far down. Seamless Acme? No. Maybe it's not here. Maybe it's just in my JNet deck builder. I know it's here somewhere. Vault Acme. Jeeves Bitcoin mining. Here we go. Shout outs to Kyle for this awesome name. Okay, this is the deck. We are playing a GFI suite. So we've got two GFIs and a bunch of two pointers. And we're playing three seamless launches. So we're essentially playing PD out of Acme. So our ice is 10 times better. And we are going to single ice like three or four servers. And we would play fully op if we could, but we can't because we want the other influence. So we're going to single ice a bunch of stuff. And then we're gonna have Jeeves on the board. We're gonna have Daily Quest. We're going to have like Regolith, and MC Austerity Policy is gonna be really annoying for the runner. And we're gonna have like three or four servers with single iced like stuff behind it. And we're gonna have these turns where we go like install three things behind Data Ward number one, like Hydro is protecting server two, and then maybe F2P is protecting server three. And we can never advance all our agendas because we have seamless launch. So we can sneak agendas through. We can also score them with MCA. We can also score them with Jeeves because they're four advancement requirements that we can just score with Jeeves. We're just gonna like completely out tempo the runner because we're taking advantage of Acme by only putting one piece of ice on every server and having multiple servers. It's a super fun deck to play. It wasn't like I was toying around with this idea for a while, and I never quite brought it anywhere, but mainly because like the more like Glaciary, End the Run, Void, Biovault ones were a bit more consistent. But I think this one's definitely the funnest one. So let's take this for a spin. So let's do this. Streaming life. Allow spectators is good, and we're corping. Okay. Do I not have this deck? G, control F. Hello? I can't control F. Okay. Vault. No, it's not here. Oh, here it is. I just missed it. Okay, we're gonna open this up on our other tab. I should figure out how to like overlay this onto JNet so that you can see the deck list at the same time. But I have not done that. But yeah, I think I can like find a way to maybe I open this on a different Chrome window and then I can overlay this on top of the game. That shouldn't be too difficult to do. Jeeves, Regolith is nice. Yes, that's fun as well. Regolith is kind of like a last resort. I think ideally you don't want to have to Regolith. This is a great hand. Let's say hi. We're going to say go out, have fun. Oops. Oops. Sorry for caps. Okay, so we're going to keep this. It's probably going to be Data Ward Rashida. And then we might get inside. Oh, actually, we can't Data Ward Rashida. What am I talking about? We're against criminal. Never mind. We're against criminal, which means we probably go like Data Ward HQ, and then we will set up Rashida next turn. Right? We go Data Ward HQ, credit, credit. We go to seven. Next turn, we go Rashida Enigma, credit. We would go to eight. Eight is not enough to res Data Ward and Enigma. That's annoying. Use the Twitch Keyhole plugin. Yeah, I'd probably just do it on OBS. Why do crims have to have diversion of funds? That'll make our life awkward. Did they keep? They kept. No, yeah, they did keep their hand. They're playing as. Like, they might not even be on diversion. But I think Data Ward HQ is always strong. We can take it slow. Okay. Let's. We can. Do we F2P R&D? I think we do. And then we'll take credit. Like, we could have double credited there, but double credit doesn't get us closer to Enigma Rashida. So we're just going to take our time and hope that Tech Trader Rezeki Drip doesn't outpace us. Which it might. It very well might. Salem's is interesting. We can draw once and then put the Enigma down. We're looking for like a hedge fund here. They have Flip Switch, which is annoying. Very annoying. Bravado? Running R&D. That's fine. They want to make us spend money on R&D so that we can't on HQ. We could res this. It's pretty annoying for them. They might pop the Flip Switch for it. But it's going to slow us down a lot. And then they can, like, diversion. That's annoying. That's annoying. We need a hedge fund really bad. Or the Plano is good. Yeah, the opening against Crim is always super hard. If we res this, we can just throw the Rashida out there. But then we can't be at 6 credits. For the data ward, and then we can get diversioned if they decide to diversion us and call us on that. And if they do, that's really bad. Although I kind of want to res this, honestly. Because they're gonna like run around with this flip switch. Yeah, okay, we're gonna res this. We're gonna make them use the flip switch. Because the thing is, if they don't use this, like they're just gonna keep poking around, and we would. Like it if they didn't do that. This is going to go on HQ, which is fine. They're going to trash Rashida. It's unfortunate. Yeah, we might just click for money here so we can res this and we'll just hold down the fort before we do anything. I don't like it. I don't like it. Okay, we're going to take the risk. We're gonna Rashida. Usually people will not just doof you, right? Because if this is F2P, or if it's like, I don't know, like anything that I can res and they doof here, that's like a bad doof, right? So they usually wouldn't. Okay. Draw, tech writer, flip switch, run the remote. So res Enigma here. They're gonna bounce, or they're gonna Q loop a boomerang off the top of their deck. Okay, we get a Rashida. Good. Okay, we're in the game. We're in the game. We need to get a sandbox card. That's when you get a sandbox card, that's where you really start doing well. This Enigma, we can stack something on the Enigma. Because the Enigma doesn't benefit off Acme. We will never put another ice on HQ. Probably never on R&D. We're just looking to make remotes here. So let's go. I do want to be able to res this data ward. Or honestly, we could just not. We could just like install Daily Quest, install F2P. Or sorry, install IP block. Or F2P, one or the other. And then res it. F2P could be good for protecting Jeeves. So let's just take the end the run so that we get the daily quest. So let's do this. And then we can put the Jeeves out naked if we want. We could put the Spin Doctor naked if we want. That's not bad. We're gonna res this. We need to install another card. Basically, is what's happening. We could pre-install the F2P. We just get the Spin Doctor out there. Yeah. We don't want it to get trashed out of hand, right? So at least we'll get two draws out of it if they run. If they don't run, we'll leave it there. They're almost definitely on Spy Camera, and Spin Doctor will be. We will want a Spin Doctor on the board if they are going to Spy Cam us. They're going to Bravado HQ after drawing, so we can't res this, so we'll let them through. One thing that I'll say is that it's important not to click this button right away and at least pretend like you're thinking about it, because if you're not thinking about it, then that means they know you can't res it. And then they can basically know that it costs more than three to res. But if it costs three or less, there are reasons not to res, right? They're gonna run this, which is fine. They have a bones now, but that bones is gonna get them a lot of value. So just because they have a bones down doesn't mean we should pop this. Is it worth getting back two Rashidas though? Right now, I want to say no. Because we just want quests, right? We just want quests and ice. So no. Any ideas for how you envision using the Salems this game? Oh, that's a good question. Oh yeah, actually. Boomerang. Boomerang is what you were using the Salems for. They're gonna get to a point where they're recurring a lot of boomerangs, and we want to Salems that if we can catch them with their boomerangs in hand. If they do it well, they can make it so that the boomerang stays in their deck and they always install it with their Q loop out of deck. But if they don't do that well, then we can hopefully Salem's boomerang. But I like that's like a long ways away. So if we end up wanting to discard a card, then that would definitely be on the chopping block. Where's this magnet going? Magnet is in here for the HB Alliance, but it's also good against Botulus. We probably want the daily quest down, so we can probably go like daily quest F2P and then magnet. So the problem with that is that we have to think about diversion, right? Because if they diversion and they force us to res this, then they can run the daily quest a bunch. Which is fine, I guess. Oh, we actually have to take a credit. So we'll have to pitch a card. We could just set up. We're gonna set up. So we're gonna go daily quest, new remote. We're going to go. You probably want the F2P here. What's their code gatebreaker? Amina? So yeah, we're probably gonna put this on archives. So let's put this here. I'm gonna put this on archives, and we're not gonna res this. We're just setting up our board, and then we're gonna res this next turn. Because if we res this now, then we have to protect it. And we can't protect this and protect from diversion. And if they diversion before running this, then they can just like run this for two credits every click. They're gonna run this click one. No, they're gonna draw two and run it click three. So they can't diversion now. We can res this just for fun. Why not? It's resources that they have to go through. They're gonna flip switch it. Makes sense. And then they're gonna get a free run on HQ, which is fine. Next turn, we'll have enough to res Data Ward and res this. Oh, they're gonna install Docklands. That's not ideal. They're trashing daily quests, which is good because we have another one on the board, which is pretty funny. And we're at $5. So we can go and take some money. And we're just gonna click the three and res this. This is good. Our agendas have stayed away, which is what you need against Crim. And now we can res this Data Ward so that Docklands Pass is not going to do much more. They're going to inside job it. That's fine. That's a resource that they're using now. Like with Hydras and Data Wards in the deck, they're going to wish they had that inside job later. So this is good. I'm not unhappy about that. And now we have a server again. Like one thing, a lot of times when you're playing Runner and you're playing a deck like this style of Acme, which is rare, but like Asa, if you trash the thing in their server, now they have a server again. So I can like put a Jeeves in there now, right? Fermenter is something that can get purged. Oh, I shouldn't be surprised that they have this. They're playing trash ability Crim. Okay, so we probably go like Hydra, New Remote, Jeeves here. And then we can even put the Spin Doctor behind the Hydra. That's probably too aggressive. Yeah, it's probably too aggressive. We can just put the Jeeves here and then call it a turn. Like I could have installed Spin Doctor, installed Hydra. But then if they run HQ and force the Data Ward res, then they'll probably run the spin. Which I guess is fine. Yeah, maybe this was better. That might have been better. Blueberry, blueberry. Yeah, this was almost definitely better now that I think about it more. Because this Jeeves isn't doing us much right now. Like if we res it, if we draw like a sandbox, we could install a bunch of stuff. I do this pretty often. It scares me too. They drew a card and installed Tech Trader. Okay, so we're gonna play the Jeeves, I think. Because we go res Jeeves, install this, res it, install, and then we can install another card and we'll end the turn at 13. And if we find an ice, then we can like ice the spin and ice the sandbox, although if they run somewhere, they would run the sandbox, right? Should we play this safe? We could go like sandbox, Hydra, spin, and then hide the Jeeves to try to score the sandbox with the Jeeves. If we install a new remote, chances are decent that they'll run it. We could go for it. Let's go for it. So we're gonna do this. We're just gonna install more stuff. Okay. So they're running the Jeeves. That's fine. Again, like Bones is good, but they're gonna use, like, they're going to use it eventually. So eventually this is going to run out. They're going to want another one. We'll see if they have more than one. But yeah, Bones is definitely a card that's going to get value against this deck. Next turn, we'll probably just put a Jeeves in there again, unless we top deck Seamless. And you know, if I can call Sandbox off the top of my deck, I can call Seamless, right? That's how this works. Draw a card, install Carmen. Carmen's a Sentry Breaker. And it costs 2, 4, 5, 6, 7 to break Hydra. All right, here we go. Sandbox off the top. No, it's another sandbox. Wait, did I say sandbox? Oh no, I meant to say seamless. Did you guys hear me? That's unfortunate. I was supposed to say seamless off the top, but I misspoke and said sandbox because they both start with an S. Well, that's great. Okay, well, now we're looking for seamless. Please? No. You totally called for sandbox just now. See, this is like I made a mistake. This is my fault. Like, we're not scoring the sandbox this turn, and that's my fault. That is so disappointing. That is so disappointing. Do we Enigma? We could go like Jeeves, Sandbox, Enigma. That's probably unnecessary. But as long as we like keep them occupied, this daily quest is safe. We're gonna do it. Jeeves, Sandbox, Enigma. And then we're probably gonna Spin Doctor at the start of next turn for Spin Doctor, and it's gonna be either Rashida or Jeeves. Daily quest is probably too slow. Like, if they run and trash this daily quest, we will want another one, but in the case that that happens, we'll have to draw it in. Oh, I guess they're gonna run it now. If they run it now, I guess, then maybe we'll Spin Doctor the daily quest. Also, Joe, I haven't done this yet, but I was gonna go through my streams, and like, I think on Twitch you can clip things. So I was gonna like clip a couple moments, and then hopefully I can easily export those to YouTube and make those into YouTube clips as well. Because there's that moment just now. There's also the moment where I installed Mamie before running R&D and going through the turning wheel logic. This IP block seems very annoying for them. Oh, it's firing. Good stuff. Good job, IP block. Okay, maybe we're not going to have to Spin Doctor Daily Quest after all. So it's probably going to be Spin Doctor, and then it's probably Jeeves, honestly. Like, I'm pretty sure they're going to contest this Jeeves. Running HQ means we res Data Ward. We're just going to get wrecked by a bunch of barriers. See, no other ID can do this, right? Res IP block and the run, res Data Ward and the run. No other ID can do this. It's so good. Like, you single ice everything, and then you just take advantage of your ID. It's so good. And then there's the few instances like here where you have two ice because the inner ice doesn't have to have the ID ability active. Like, this Hydra is another server where we could stack. Like, if they get really good at running the right stuff, then we could put a Data Ward on top of this Hydra. But for now, we are going to draw a Seamless when we have a Jeeves. Always, you know, you love to see that. This Hydra, I guess, is the safer server, so we will score this sandbox. Oh, I forgot to Spin Doctor. That's fine. Okay, let's score this. You all know what's about to happen, right? Like, we're gonna score the other one next turn, and then we're gonna purge for eight. Gotta bounce. Love the stream. Thanks for the Australian time zone friendly content. Hey, thanks for dropping by. I didn't know it was Australian time zone friendly, but I'll take the credit. glad you're enjoying it. Install Boomerang. Okay, they have the Boomerang this time. So now they're gonna come in and trash this daily quest. But the thing is, they're probably not gonna run this. So what did they do? Oh, they installed it from hand. Like, they're not gonna run this, so if we purge for 8, we don't need daily quest anymore. So at the end of the turn, at the end of their turn, if we are able to score this, then we're gonna spin for probably. It'll be a tough call. Because Rashida is one to trash, and you don't. Like, if you're 4-0 up as the runner, you're probably gonna try to get central accesses. And you don't want Rashida in your deck. But at the same time, drawing Rashida would be amazing. Jeeves is good too. Although Jeeves is necessary to score this. Because we put this down and then we have to triple advance and then seamless to score it. Unless you pre-advance it, which nobody does around here. 3:11 p.m. on the east coast of Australia right now. Awesome. Yeah, I guess if you're yeah, like if you're not working on Fridays or don't have other daytime commitments. Okay, let's pop the spin doctor though. So spin doctor again. Rashida's good. Jeeves is. I would rather have the Jeeves if they trashed this Jeeves. I do expect them to trash this Jeeves. But if we Rashida, we can like draw faster. The F2P is kind of annoying for them. Let's take the Rashida. All right. And then we can go ahead and score this. And then we purge for 8. And now, we're good. Now we just have to not lose. Before, we were trying to get into a decent position. I guess before we were trying to not lose as well. But like now we're in like a great spot. Turning wheel into R&D. Yeah, like as I said, like this is the reason why you don't want to spin the Rashida, because it costs one to trash. So if they trash Rashida here, that'll be unfortunate. Looks like it's not. They draw Sure Gamble and play Sure Gamble. We keep the Jeeves. That's sick. You guys ready for this play? We're about to install GFI, install Data Ward here, install the other GFI, and install IP block here. I think that's what we're doing. They can't run both of these, right? Do I have the money to do that? Maybe we just purge install. The problem is, if they get curious and run HQ and they like Docklands double GFI, that'll be unfortunate. Let's say thinking. Okay. If we install ice here, they can. This costs us $2 to install, so that'll be at 13. If we install this ice here, we'll be at 12. We need $4 to score the GFI, so we can't res the Hydra. We can res the Data Ward. So it could just be like GFI Data Ward. That's probably good enough. We don't have the money to threaten a second one, unfortunately. But that's like the flashy play that this deck can do, is that you can just like Asa, except it's bet you can do it better than Asa, is that you can install agendas in multiple servers, and in a relatively safe way. But this seems good though. Let's do this. Install. I think we're good. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Or sorry, 10. This costs us 10. So we can pre-install the IP block for a future turn. We're probably going to use this server for the rest of the game, though. So we'll just take a credit. Is Ward on a new server and then doubling up GFI worthwhile, or is the Jeeves too fragile for that play? Ward on a new server and then doubling up GFI. So I put GFI behind the IP block Enigma. The IP block Enigma only costs them $5, four if they run last click. Three if they Abignale the Enigma. So that's where I feel like it's a little easy to give up. But yeah, like you might be right. Like you, because they have to run through the data ward anyways, and they run both servers, but they're not going to run at all. So we are going to get the beautiful top deck seamless when I didn't need it, and win the game from there. Oh, that was good. That was a good showcase of what this deck is able to do. It's so much fun. It's so much fun. There's so many ways to score, and yeah, like with Jeeves, you can score with like there's three Jeeves, there's three Seamless, you, and like with Acme, like if you're not against Crim, which means they don't have diversion, like a lot of times turn one you like agenda, IP block, and then you have Seamless in hand, and you can just Seamless score Sandbox turn two, and like. And you're protecting it with IP block, and PD doesn't have a 2/4 end the run barrier with a on encounter tag. So yeah, it's a super fun deck. Okay. Yeah, I'm gonna call a stream there. Hope everybody had fun. I know I did. This was great, playing those three games. And as I said, I'm gonna try to make clips, and kind of showcase little highlights. It's not really gonna be like highlights per se. It's kind of just gonna be funny moments, and things like calling Sandbox off the top of my deck when I really wanted Seamless and I just misspoke. That's hilarious. Also very sad. And face cam is another thing that I'm going to try to do for next week. And then we'll see what I can do about music. Although I feel like music probably has, it's probably harder to do. So I'll have to try to talk to somebody about music. Yeah, I'm not going to play music while I play. Like it'll only be like intro music, if any music at all. Because I definitely don't want anything in the background while I'm playing. If y'all think otherwise, please let me know. I'll be interested to hear it. But other than that, that's pretty much it. Thanks everybody for stopping by. Yeah. All right. Great stream. Do you have much content on YouTube? So on YouTube, I currently post my VODs. So my past streams, I'll just take the entire 3 hours of, or 2.5 today of my stream, and I'll put it on here. So that's if you're interested in watching the whole stream, but you're not able to live. But other than that, there's nothing here yet. Again, like I just started at the start of this month. I do plan, for sure on having specific YouTube content. So as I said, I'm gonna try to clip certain moments from my streams, and I will post like I imagine there'll be like 10, 20 second little funny clips that I'll have on here that I'll post. But in addition, I will probably make like little videos as well, that'll be just for YouTube. I don't have any ideas on what that would look like right now. But once new things start coming, I'll definitely do that. So for example, like I know that there's a new set that's coming out soon. So when those new cards come out, or when those new cards are announced, I imagine Don't hold me to this, but I imagine I'll do something like a card review, talking through the cards, talking through how, like, whether or not I like them, what kind of decks they can go into, stuff like that. If there's like a specific deck archetype video, I know Ysengrin does replay reviews. I am definitely up for doing those as well. So yeah, I do expect other things on coming out on YouTube. But as I said, no concrete plans as of right now. Not a content creators on a replay review. Yeah, okay, I'll definitely do replay reviews. Like for those watching right now, and I'll try to shout this out wherever. If anybody at all wants to send me replays to do reviews, I will definitely do that, and I will make YouTube videos doing replay reviews because I think those are super interesting. And it's definitely useful to get another person's insight on your plays. Yeah, I've seen Ysengrin do a couple of those. And yeah, like I think I'd be able to do those in a pretty interesting and in a a useful way. So that's definitely something I'm up for doing. So send in your replays. I would love to do that. Okay. So yeah, that's it for today. Thanks everybody for stopping by. I'm going to stop the stream there and hope to see you all next week.